like a Red Hat box, and they try to install something like a Samba server, and they try to share a directory, and they don't know how to deal with SL Linux, and hey, Samba is not working, and if I disable SL Linux, Samba is working, so let's get rid of it completely. So the idea of this talk is that after this talk there's no reason to turn off SL Linux anymore. Even better, you can go get any other distribution and start configuring SL Linux for yourself on that distribution. That is what I've done. I've configured SL Linux in particular on different versions of SUSE, and that works. So before going into details, why do you need SL Linux? Well, simply said, it's offering good security. Just one example, how are you going to ensure that the web server that's running hundreds of scripts is really secure? I mean, which system administrator really knows what's going on in all the scripts that are offered on the web server? And if you just have one badly configured script, an intruder can just break through the script, get shell access. And he doesn't even need shell access as a root account. Shell access with the web server account is bad enough under bad circumstances to put scripts in some directories and to start bothering the rest of the world. And this is something that's very difficult to avoid given the basic solutions that Linux is offering. Because on Linux there are a couple of directories where every user can create files. And hey, how are you going to prevent that? Do you really want to take away write permission from the TMP directory and the var TMP directory? I don't think so, because it's useful to have those permissions in those directories. And that is where SL Linux is going to help. So the purpose of SL Linux is very effective. It basically blocks all syscalls, which means that if you enable SL Linux and you don't do anything else, nothing works. That's not cool, so you need to do something to make sure that those syscalls that you want to be able to be working, that they are enabled. Once you start doing that, you will probably lose some functionality, because it's very difficult to have an overview of a system, of completely everything that's happening on the system, and configuring it in a way that everything works the way it should work. And that is where the policy comes in. The policy is a key component in SL Linux. It is used to define which objects get access to other objects and in which way. Wow, objects getting access to other objects. Well, the basics of SL Linux is the context label. The context label that is set on items like the file system, like directories, like ports. And these context labels, they have to match the accessing objects, which means that if your web server wants to access a given file, there's a context label set for the web server, and that needs to match the context label that is set for the file. Let me just give you a simple example of what this looks like. I hope this prompt is readable. Is it readable?
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to do ls minus z. This gives you an overview of all the context labels that are set in my current directory, which is set to default underscore t, which already reveals that something is not quite okay on this system, because it's the home directory of user root. If I do the same thing, ls minus z is the option that you can use to find out more information about context labels that are set. You can see, for example, that sbin has been labeled with bin type. SRV has been labeled with var type. USR has been labeled with USR type. Now, if there is a web server which typically has the HTTP D type, In a rule in the policy, there's a definition that the web server with the HTTPD type can only access a limited amount of specifically labeled files. And there is no way on earth that a web server will be able to access a directory that has TMP type, because that is prevented by the policy. Now, an interesting thing is that you can also find out which types are set for processes that are running on your server, like a command like PSAUX, and again uppercase Z. You can see the context labels that are set for all the processes on the machine. But let's get back to the slide, because I only have 20 minutes. So the policy is the key component of SL Linux, and in the policy there's a context, and the context consists of three different parts, which is the user, the role, and the type. Depending on the kind of policy that you are going to use, you can either work with all three of those types, or just with the context type, which is what we have just seen, what you can use to label files. Now, in the policy, you will have rules, and the rules, they will define what exactly is possible. And by default, there are many different policies available. If, for example, you look at Red Hat, Red Hat is basically the distribution behind SL Linux nowadays. Red Hat has different policies. Policies that are very restrictive and that don't allow anything unless it is specifically allowed. Policies that are a little bit less restrictive and that do allow you to run services without protection of SL Linux, and even multi-level security policies. Now, the policy is also the problem if you are going to work with a distribution that doesn't support SL Linux. Because in the policy, you need rules for all files and all processes on your server. Now, it took Red Hat a couple of years to write decent policies for their Linux environments. And basically, it's only since Red Hat 6 that SL Linux really is perfect on Red Hat. Now, if you have a look at a distribution like SUSE, SUSE in their SUSE Linux Enterprise Server 11.2, they have stated that from now on they are supporting SL Linux on the SUSE platform, but they don't deliver any policy. They tell their customers, hey, we do SL Linux, but we don't have a policy. Go figure out for yourself. Now, if you realize that in an average policy, you will have at least a couple of thousands of different rules that are working with thousands of different context types, you do realize that tuning a policy is really complicated. So if you want to enable SL Linux on a distribution that doesn't have SL Linux by default, find yourself a policy and go tune it. And that will take a lot of time before you've got it perfect. I have a couple of hints in the remaining slides on what you can do to get a policy for yourself. But first, let's have a look a little bit more about how the policy is working. The best way of using a policy is by using a modular policy, which means that, like, everything okay?
Yeah, everything's fine.
That means like a Linux kernel, that there are different modules that you can load and that you can unload, which makes it very easy to work with the policy. There is a couple of files involved. The PP file is a compiled policy file, and you can enable them, disable them using the SE module command. I have tried to include all the relevant commands, the most interesting commands, in these slides here, and SE module definitely is an interesting one that is going to allow you to enable the functionality that you really need. Related to that, there are also some input files. These are the .te, the .if, and the .fc files. Now, if you are interested in seeing how those rules in SL Linux are composed, it's a good idea to have a look at those files. Because if you take some time and if you understand the concept of SL Linux, yeah, they are impressive, but they are not that hard to understand. They are just humanly readable. Now, managing SU Linux, what do you need to be able to do as a system administrator? Well, first you need to check if it's alive, which means SE status will show you if your system is using SU Linux, yes or no. This is in particular a very important command if you try to enable SU Linux on a distribution that doesn't do SU Linux by default. Next, in managing SU Linux, use permissive mode to start from scratch. That may sound like bad practice, but at least if you use permissive mode, that is the mode where SU Linux is fully operational, but it doesn't block anything. In permissive mode, you can analyze what is happening, and at the same time, you still have functionality on your system. Because if you do enable a badly configured SU Linux policy and you install it, put it in enabled mode, your kernel will probably panic because it can't start the init process or whatever it's starting properly, because that's prevented by SU Linux. So if you really want to build it from scratch, starting in permissive mode really is important. The next task as a system administrator you will frequently do, you will use SEManage. SEManage is the flexible command that you can use to set context on files, on ports, on whatever you need to have context on. Then we also have setSubool. SU Linux uses booleans, and those booleans are a very easy way to change the default behavior of your policy. Let me give an example. There is one boolean that says FTP allow anonymous upload. By default, on FTP, SU Linux doesn't allow anonymous upload, and there's a rule that specifically states that. Now, instead of changing the entire rule, you can just change the boolean by using set SE bool, which will actually compile the change into the policy if you use the right option with that. I have another slide that shows a couple of examples with those commands. Then we have SE module. SE module, we already talked about that. SE module is what you can use if some part of the configuration is causing you a headache. Because with SE module, you can simply enable or disable SU Linux protection for a specific module. Also very useful if you are installing your system, if you are configuring it for SU Linux, is to use auditing. Every modern Linux has audit-d. Audit-d writes audit messages to the audit log. Normally those are humanly nearly unreadable messages. But hey, if you take a couple of minutes, you will understand what they tell, and you will exactly understand what SU Linux is trying to disallow you to do. And next, you can use a useful tool, audit to allow. Now, what audit to allow is doing is interesting, especially from a security perspective, because audit to allow reads the denial messages, and you can use audit to allow to turn those denial messages into policies, policies that will allow the activity that has been denied before. Yeah, that makes that your system will work even with your SU Linux policy, but you should be very careful when using audit to allow, because hey, SU Linux is trying to secure your system, and you might open your system too much by just using audit to allow without understanding what you are doing. And do not use setEnforce to turn it off. SetEnforce normally is the only command that system administrators know about SU Linux. It's what you use to switch SU Linux to permissive mode, which means that it doesn't protect your system anymore. I just mentioned just use audit to allow instead. There's a couple of options that you can use audit to allow with. I'm not going through every single line here in the slide, just wanted you to have the useful commands in the slide. The idea behind audit to allow is the audit to allow minus A minus M command. That will create an SU Linux policy module, so that's a PP file, and next you can use SE module to enable this module. Now, some examples of common administration commands. Basically, if you want to work with SL Linux on an administrator level, that means you have Red Hat, CentOS, Fedora, or anything that comes natively with SL Linux. That means you don't have to care about the policy. Basically, what you do, you will work with commands like SE-manage. And yes, there are different alternatives for using SE-manage, but SE-manage is the most flexible of all the managing commands. And you will use commands like the first. Now, I know that this is not the type of command that you type easily out of your head, but fortunately, SEManage has a very good man page, and in the end of the man page, there are examples, and this just comes from the example. Just the only thing you need to do, you need to find out what exactly is the context type that I need. In this example, the context type is HTTPD sysContentity, which is needed to open a directory for a web server. The challenge that you have is that there's about 3,000 different context types available. So you need to find the appropriate context type. There are different ways of doing that. Use your good friend Google, for example, or just have a look at the default configuration. I mean, every web server on an SL Linux system has a default document root. And if the web server by default works, just check the context type that is set for the default document root, and then you know what you need to do. Or just do SE info minus T and grep on the output of the command to find which context types are available. Next, when you have set the context type, you need to run restore con, because SEManage is going to write the context type that you want to use to the policy, and you need to apply it. Restore con minus R is going to do that. In this example, on the directory web and everything that exists in that directory. Now, another command, I already mentioned them, the booleans, getsable and setsable. Getsable minus A shows you all the booleans that are available. Grep on something like FTP or whatever you need, and you will find very easily the boolean that you need exactly. I think I have 2 minutes left to talk about installing SE Linux. Now, this is something that you can read in much more detail in the article that I've put on my website. Now, basically, the idea is that you need to enable some kernel options. So what you need is security is SE Linux. SE Linux is 1 and enforcing is 0. Enforcing is 0 puts SE Linux in permissive mode so that you can be sure that it still works. Then you need a policy. Now what I recommend you to do is to download a source file containing the policy sources and compile them yourselves. In order to do that, build.conf is an important configuration file. In the build.conf, you tell the SE Linux the make command that you want to work with a modular policy. And next, you can continue the configuration. Most important part of this is the SE Linux ready script. The SE Linux ready script will check the current configuration on your server and tell you what exactly you are missing. And based on the SE Linux ready script, you are going to execute the other commands that are listed on this slide. In particular, interesting, all this to why. Why is the action that I want to perform on this server denied? Audit to why will tell you exactly, and it will tell you exactly what you need to do in order to enable it. Additional questions? I already knew that I was running out of time by the moment that I got to this slide. You are more than welcome to send the additional questions if you have them by email. I always try to answer short mail messages, but maybe you have time for one or two questions.
Yeah, we could have one or two questions while Thomas is setting up.
Wow, that's a lot. Well, in that case, I say thank you very much. It's a real pleasure being here in Australia.